Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Pastor Eli James, and this is another study from the Church of the Restoration of Israel, which is a Christian identity church teaching that the Anglo-Saxon, Celtic, and Caucasian people, not the Jews, are the true Israelites of the Bible. Today's study is going to be entitled Sodom and Egypt. And the reason I felt compelled to do this study is because the mainstream churches, the churches of modern heresies, the Judeo-Christian churches, have capitulated to the idea that homosexuality is acceptable to the God of the Bible, to Yahweh God, or even to Jesus the Christ, Yahshua Messiah. We find that in the secular world, the academics, the entertainers, you can't turn on television without seeing the idea of homosexuality being promoted. Unfortunately, that's bad enough. But we find that the churches either wink at this idea and say, or they actively promote it, saying, well, love the sinner, hate the sin. There's no such verse in the Bible that says love the sinner, hate the sin. I'm going to demonstrate to you today that even in the New Testament, homosexuals are condemned. That's right. Even in the New Testament, homosexuals are condemned. There is no place in Christianity for homosexuals. They must go. Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 6 that we are not to follow or fellowship with unbelievers. Now, you either believe what the Bible says, or you're an unbeliever. If you believe 90% of what it says and don't believe the rest of it, you're an unbeliever. If you believe 99% and you choose not to believe the remaining 1%, you're an unbeliever. The Bible is consistent from Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22, verse 21. It's totally consistent from beginning to end. Teaches the same message, does not deviate, does not bring in so-called spiritual Israel under the new covenant. That's all modern heretical teaching, which is part of the great apostasy prophesied by Paul in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, which we will get to. Now, all of these slogans of the modern apostates, the Judeo-Christian churches, which is, of course, a contradiction in terms, because Judaism totally rejects the idea that Yahshua Messiah, Jesus Christ, is the Messiah of Israel. He's certainly not their Messiah. They totally reject him. And Christianity, by definition, accepts Jesus Christ as the Messiah. So you cannot have a doctrine which both accepts and denies the messianic mission of Jesus Christ. It's either one or the other. They are mutually exclusive doctrines. There is no such thing as Judeo-Christianity. There is Judaism, there is Christianity, and the twain shall never meet. You have these Judeo-Christian pastors making slogans like, Jesus loves everybody, or the law has been done away with, or hate the sin and love the sinner, and multitudes of these pat slogans that are simply untrue. The Bible says no such thing. You can look up the Jesus loves everybody. You'll find it nowhere stated in the Bible. In fact, Jesus Christ, Yahshua Messiah, will return as the grim reaper. He's the one whose vesture will be dipped in blood to judge the nations according to their works. According to their works, folks. That's what the Bible says. It does not say that if you merely believe in Jesus Christ, that you will be saved. Nowhere does the Bible say that either. It says, yeah, you have to believe. You have to believe, but it says, only those who overcome shall be saved. You have to be an overcomer. And of course, James, be also a doer of the works, not just a hearer of the word only. and the churches have radically reinterpreted and misinterpreted and distorted the scriptures in order to purvey false doctrine, which is antithetical to the Bible, and this idea that homosexuality or sodomy is acceptable to God is an absolute blasphemy, and I'm going to prove it to you here today. So I'm going to quote Revelation 11:8, which talks about Sodom and Egypt, and the Bible tells us there will come a day when the Israelites of the world will be yet again enslaved, and we are experiencing that slavery today. And part of that enslavement includes the idea that homosexuality is acceptable. Well, Paul says that to whomever you obey, you are a servant to that. And so if you obey sin, you are a servant of sin. If you practice homosexuality, you are a servant of sin. Revelation 11, verse 8. Speaking of the two witnesses, and their bodies shall lie in the street of the great city, which is spiritually is called Sodom and Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified. So, what we're being told here, Sodom, of course, is symbolic of old Sodom and Gomorrah, which Yahweh destroyed because of their illicit sexual activities. It wasn't just homosexuality. They were doing all kinds of things there. Bestiality, wife swapping, homosexuality, whatever you could think of in terms of fornication, race mixing, whatever you want to lump up under the term sodomy. It's fornication, it's homosexuality, it's wife swapping, it's illicit sex of all kinds. That's what sodomy is. But we know primarily as homosexuality. And so we're also being told that which spiritually is called Sodom and Egypt. Well, what's Egypt symbolic of? Egypt symbolizes slavery. So it's telling us that there's a day coming which is symbolized by homosexuality and slavery. And we are living in those days now because all of us have been enslaved by the Rothschild international banking system called fractional reserve banking, which has enslaved the entire world. Only two nations on the face of the globe are not part of the Rothschild economic slavery system, and those are North Korea and Iran. That's why those two nations are being attacked furiously by the Jewish-owned press. Now, to establish what's going on here, we need to know who the covenant people are, with whom the covenants were made, therefore they do not apply to anyone else. So in Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 31, we are told that there's only one group of people to whom these covenants apply. The new covenant, which was established by Yahshua Messiah at the cross when he redeemed Israel, that is, forgiving the sins, the old sins, the past sins, not future sins, but only the old sins and past sins. This era of grace does not mean that you can continue to sin. What it means is grace is available to you if you repent, and only if you repent. It's not available to you if you do not repent. If you believe that murder and sodomy and theft are not punishable offenses and can continue doing these things without repercussions, well, I guarantee you that if you believe that, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. You will not be saved. Whatever you mean by that word, it ain't going to happen. You're going to be condemned because you will be judged by your works, not by your beliefs. And if you have false beliefs, you're going to act accordingly. You're going to act according to your false beliefs, and you're going to continue sinning, and you will not enter the kingdom. New Covenant, Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 31. Behold, the days come, saith Yahweh, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was an husband unto them, saith Yahweh. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. Remember, covenants made with two entities, house of Israel and the house of Judah. The same two houses of the Old Testament. Yahweh is telling us here through Jeremiah that the old covenant will be renewed with the same people. The new covenant will be with the same people, house of Israel, house of Judah. And let's just continue here. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith Yahweh. I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts and will be their God, and they shall be my people. What don't you understand? I will write my law in their hearts. The idea that the law has been done away with in the New Testament is blasphemy, folks. It's absolute blasphemy. Nowhere does the Bible teach any such thing, and here the New Covenant tells us very specifically that He is going to write His law in our hearts. In other words, He's going to give us a new conscience by which we obey His laws via our consciences and are not inclined to do evil acts. Israelites have to be taught how to do evil acts. They are not so inclined from birth and in their daily activity. Now you compare that to the other races on the planet, which have been very brutal in their history, even toward their own. Blacks in Africa have enslaved their own people, constant tribal warfare, killing each other. Not that white people haven't done so either, but in modern times, the warfare has been caused by other entities, such as the Jewish House of Rothschild staging war, such as the Roman Catholic Church going on around the world, converting by the sword, etc., etc. The white race, true Israel, is not inclined to violence. We have to learn these things. Someone else has to hire us to do these things, such as the Jews and their corporate war machine called Zionism, deceives us into going into these wars. And when you arouse the righteous anger of an Israelite, yes, then that Israelite is willing to fight. But if you deceive that Israelite, he will be fighting for the wrong cause. He will not be fighting for the causes of the book, of the Bible. So let's go now to Daniel chapter 2. And I want to establish for you here today the entity which is enslaving you, and the history, the historical perspective of the Bible, which demonstrates the nature of this entity, the nature of this enslaving power. So for section A here, I'm going to be talking about slavery and who, about the Egypt function here of the prophecy of Revelation 11:8. And then we will switch to the sodomy portion. So first, to establish the slavery aspect of our modern enslavement by the beast. So in Daniel chapter 2, verses 31 through 45, and I'll just repeat these piecemeal, the ones that are most important. Thou, O king, speaking to Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. This is Daniel during the captivity period, captivity to Babylon. Thou, O king, Daniel is saying to Nebuchadnezzar, sawest, and behold, a great image. This great image, whose brightness was excellent, stood before thee, and the form thereof was terrible or awesome. This image's head was of fine gold, his breast and his arms of silver, his belly and his thighs of brass, his legs of iron, his feet part of iron and clay. Thou sawest till that a stone was cut out without hands, which smote the image upon his feet that were of iron and clay, and brake them to pieces." So here we're being given four beasts plus a kingdom which will never die. Let me just jump to verse 45 for you to get the complete picture. "And forasmuch as thou sawest that the stone was cut out of the mountain without hands, and that it brake in pieces the iron, the brass, the clay, the silver, and the gold, the great God hath made known to the king what shall come to pass hereafter, and the dream is certain, and its interpretation is sure." In other words, this stone cut out without hands is a reference to true Christianity, the Christianity of true Israel, the covenant people of the Bible. That covenant Christianity is going to destroy all of these kingdoms that Daniel is speaking of. So let's identify these kingdoms. Of course, the kingdom of gold is Babylon. That's the kingdom that Nebuchadnezzar was the king of, which was followed historically. Babylon was defeated by the Medes and Persians. So Medo-Persia is the kingdom of silver. Greece is the kingdom of brass. And Rome is the kingdom of iron, and its feet being a mixture of iron and clay. So we have identified here, and this is basic historical analysis of many theologians who have put this together and identified these four beasts as, in fact, kingdoms that came and went after Daniel issued this prophecy. And the book of Daniel gets more and more specific. In fact, it describes that the Grecian Empire is broken into four parts, and we know that the Grecian Empire was divided into four parts, four kings, after the death of Alexander. So we can see that these prophecies are very specific and have been fulfilled in very specific events in the historical record. So if you study this very carefully, you'll understand how this is. So once we have established these four kings or four kingdoms, four beasts of Daniel, we can now go to the book of Revelation and tie these together, because Revelation, in fact, talks about eight beasts that will occur throughout history and culminate in the beast called Mystery Babylon. So let's go to Revelation 1:1, verses 1 through 7, and see what this book has to tell us, because it's very important that you understand these prophecies made in the book of Revelation, and throughout the whole Bible. If you cannot understand these prophecies and their historical outworking, their historical development, their historical fulfillment, you will simply not understand the Bible. And the fact is, folks, there's only one denomination, if we could call ourselves a denomination, that understands these things and can put them in historical perspective. It is Christian Identity. No other denomination has any idea of how these prophecies have been fulfilled and by whom they are fulfilled. Well, I'm going to explain it to you right now, who these beasts are. But first, Revelation 1, verse 1, "The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. And he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John." In other words, these prophecies that John wrote down will begin happening shortly after they were jotted down by John. And indeed, that's exactly how it started out, because the first prophecies deal with the seven churches, which were actually cities in existence in in Turkey. And that these churches, their congregations, were founded by Israelites of the various tribes. And these Israelite tribes were relatively good, but they had bad aspects of their culture as well, and that's what these churches are all about. At the same time, these literal churches, these literal congregations from the specific cities named, they're also prophetic statements talking about the ages which they represent. So, but let's go. Let's continue here. Verse 2, the servant John, who bear record of the word of God and of the testimony of Jesus Christ and of all things that he saw. Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. As I said, these prophecies began to be fulfilled right after John wrote them down, and they are still being fulfilled in our day, because this is a historical series of prophecies which you can trace from the day he took this dictation to our present time. Many of these prophecies, most of these prophecies, have already been fulfilled, and only some of them yet to be fulfilled, such as the prophecy of the Battle of Armageddon, the Battle of Gog and Magog, the judgment of the beast and the false prophet, and the judgment of the dragon. These things have yet to be fulfilled, but just about everything else in Scripture has already been fulfilled. That is, in the book of Revelation, I should say. Just about all the other prophecies have been fulfilled, because we have the historical record to prove it. So, from Jesus, John to the seven churches, of course, verse 4 immediately addresses the subject of the churches, which are in Asia, Asia being Turkey, Greece as we know it today. Grace be unto you and peace from him which is and which was and which is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead, or he was the first one to rise from the dead. And many of us, many of our ancestors, Israelite ancestors, will follow suit at the judgment day. They will rise from the dead. And the prince of the kings of the earth, which he is not yet, but he will be when the kingdom comes, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, us, of course, John is a member of the tribe of Benjamin, so he is an Israelite. He's speaking about the Israelites. Remember, the covenant was made to the house of Israel, house of Judah. It does not mention any other people being members of the covenant. Behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. What's it telling us? It's telling us that the world is going to dread the day that he returns. It's not going to be pretty, folks, because that's going to be the day of judgment. And all of the kingdoms of the world that do not line up with the stone that smashed the image of, that is the rock, our rock, is Yahshua Messiah, Jesus the Christ. Anyone who does not conform himself to the teachings of Jesus Christ will be out. They will be judged. And that applies even more to the Israelites, to Christian Israel, because we're expected to conform. 1 John says, love not the world. You're not supposed to love this world. Your whole purpose as an Israelite in being in this world is to prepare yourself for the kingdom. And if you're sinning, you're not going to be ready when it happens. Let's jump now to Revelation 17, verses 1 through 18. Because we're going to tie all of these beasts, these seven beasts of Revelation, together with what we just read from the book of Daniel. And we're going to read the entire chapter of Revelation 17. And there came one of the seven angels which had the seven vials, and talked to me, saying unto me, come hither, I will show unto thee the judgment of the great whore that sitteth upon many waters. Waters being representative of nations and peoples and tongues. What is the great whore that sits upon all the nations of the world? Well, I just told you that the Jewish banking system, otherwise known as fractional reserve banking, headquartered in London under the House of Rothschild, Bank of England, and the most powerful branch of which is the Federal Reserve Bank in Washington, D.C., with a large, I think the main branch is in New York City, and the United Nations being a Rockefeller Rothschild entity, being Mystery Babylon, being a reversion, a remake of Nimrod's Tower of Babel. That's what the United Nations is. That, and you have those two elements of Mystery Babylon today, that these entities will be judged. They will be judged. They will be destroyed. Nothing will be left of them. Verse 2, therefore, and Jesus Christ himself is going to lead an army of angels in this destruction. So don't tell me that Jesus loves everybody. He certainly does not love sinners, because sinners will be judged according to their works. They will not be automatically forgiven, as the churches falsely teach today. Verse 2. With whom, talking about this great whore, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. In other words, the entire world is indulging itself in the fornications of Mystery Babylon. Drunkenness, harlotry, debauchery, theft, murder. All nations are indulging in it. Wars, staged wars that accomplish absolutely nothing but victimize everybody in its path. The Zionist war machine is the biggest war machine that the earth has ever known, and it is run by the House of Rothschild from their London bank. And all of the banks of the world provide funds for these wars, and all these wars do is they continue the oppression of the people of the world, not just Israel, but the whole world. And they arrange for wars between nations so that the people might be destroyed and oppressed. None of these wars accomplish democracy. That's total fiction. They deceive you into believing that they will accomplish good when in fact they accomplish nothing but dictatorship, economic dictatorship by the House of Rothschild. And let's continue. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit up on a scarlet-colored beast, full of names of blasphemy, having seven heads and ten horns. I won't get into the ten horns today, but the original ten horns were the nations such as the Burgundians and the Alans and Sueves, who were part of the ten original nations of the Holy Roman Empire. I think we're going to have a second fulfillment, a dual fulfillment of this prophecy, namely the BRICS nations, which are rebelling against the Rothschild banking system. And these BRICS nations are Brazil, Russia, Iran, China, and I forget what the S stands for, but we can see, maybe Syria, but we can see that these BRICS nations are coalescing as we speak. And they are intent upon setting up an economic system which is not dependent upon the Rothschild fractional reserve banking system. And the reason why they're breaking away from this is because the Federal Reserve note has been so inflated by printing press money and by money created out of thin air on your computer. This is computer digits is all it is. That this money has been inflated to such an extent that none of these BRICS nations are willing to accept Federal Reserve notes anymore. And therefore they are rebelling against the Rothschild fractional reserve banking system. Verse 4, and the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. All you have to do is look at the world order we live in today. It's full of abominations and fornication. Sinfulness, child pornography, child slavery, slavery of all kinds. It's happening today under the same entity, the United Nations, which claims to be here to establish peace. But there's no peace. Since the creation of the United Nations, there have been even more wars, constant war. War every day, every hour, every minute. They have not created peace. It's a lie. And because the whole world has been deceived by this lie, they follow the United Nations, they follow the Zionists, they follow the warmonger corporations, believing that they're fighting to achieve democracy. What a joke! It's an absolute joke. Open your eyes. You've got to see that these entities are not creating peace in any way. Verse 5. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. So you can see that Mystery Babylon is the mother of all abominations, which includes wars, organized crime, the fractional reserve banking system of the House of Rothschild is that harlot. And we will see that throughout history, the harlot is nothing other than bankers, money lenders, money changers. What was the first thing that Jesus did when he went to Jerusalem? He took a whip and he drove the money changers out of the temple. That's an example to us, folks. That's what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to drive these money changers out of our nations. Verse 6. And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. Wow. I mean, if you actually appreciate the power of the House of Rothschild in controlling nations, in making and destroying nations, and that's what they do. They have the economic power to destroy nations. And they can build nations, they can create new nations, which is what they have done throughout history since 1815. The League of Nations being a perfect example of how the Rothschilds carved up Europe and other parts of the world, creating nations that never existed and taking territory from Germany, let's say, and giving it to Poland, and things like that, and creating Yugoslavia, which never existed before then. This is what the economic power of this Jewish banking house is capable of. Verse 7. And the angel said unto me, Wherefore didst thou marvel? I will tell thee the mystery of the woman and the beast that carrieth her, which hath the seven heads and ten horns. The beast that thou sawest was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit, and go into perdition. And they that dwell on the earth shall wonder, whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they behold the beast that was, and is not, and yet is. What is this verse saying? Well, we're told that there are seven beasts. So, four of these seven beasts conform to the four beasts of Daniel chapter 2, which I just quoted. And these were Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, and Rome. And we know that in the case of each of these beasts, the previous beast was defeated militarily by the succeeding beast. So Babylon was defeated by the Medes and Persians. The Medes and Persians were defeated by Greece. Greece was defeated by Rome. So we have a military succession of these empires. But in Revelation tells us there are seven beasts. Well, we can correlate the four beasts of Daniel by incorporating them into this image of seven beasts. All we have to do is understand that Babylon defeated a kingdom before it, namely Assyria, and that Assyria defeated a kingdom before it, namely Egypt. So we have a succession of these beasts. We have six beasts, and hold on, I have to turn my phone off because I can't answer this phone right now. And it's going to keep beeping until I'm done with this message. So I have to, I have to turn my phone off. And so when we add Egypt and Assyria to these beasts, we have identified six. Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, and Rome. We have six. And this, in each case, we have each preceding empire being defeated militarily by the succeeding empire. And this is the absolute connection from one beast to the next. But yet, it tells us here that there is one beast that was and is not and yet is. Well, let's go back to the third beast, Babylon. We know that from the vantage point of John, as he was being given this prophecy, that Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, Medo-Persia, and Greece had all vanished from the scene. They are no longer present. However, Rome, the sixth beast, is present because he's living in Roman times. And so let's read this again. Whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of when they beheld the holy beast that was and is not and yet is. What this is telling us is that one of these previous five beasts is going to be reborn and yet is. That's the language. Let's continue. And here is the mind which hath wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sitteth. Now, I know there's denominations that teach that these are the seven hills of Rome, but that can't possibly be because we're talking about seven beasts, and not all of them sat on the hills of Rome. Indeed, these are all kingdoms. These are all empires. Not one empire that sits on seven hills. And the proof is in the next verse, verse 10. And there are seven kings. So these mountains are not literal mountains, they are kingdoms. Each one of them being led by kings. Five are fallen, and one is, and the other is not yet come, and when he cometh, he must continue a short space. So in other words, it's very clear that this prophecy is telling us that we're talking about kingdoms, not literal mountains. And if your pastor or your denomination teaches otherwise, it's just proof that they do not comprehend these scriptures. So it says there must be a seventh, which was the seventh. Well, let's just rename them again. We have Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, Rome. That's the sixth. And then it says, when the seventh comes, he will continue a short space. One thing we have to understand about the Roman beast is that it consisted of two stages. One which followed the other. So before we identify beast number seven, let's just learn a little bit more about beast number six, Rome. And so from Revelation 13, 1 and 3, and I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having seven heads and ten horns, and upon his horns ten crowns, kingdoms, okay? And upon his heads the name of blasphemy. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion, and the dragon gave him his power, and his seat, and his great authority. The dragon, who's the dragon? Satan, Lucifer. Verse 3, and I saw one of his heads, as it were, wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed, and all the world wondered after the beast. And they worshipped the dragon, which gave power unto the beast, and they worshipped the beast, saying, who is like unto the beast? Who is able to make war with him? Well, certainly when, as each one of these seven beasts was at the height of its power, there were no other empires capable of making war against these beasts. But in the case of Rome, which was the longest lived of all the kingdoms we're talking about here, it existed in two stages. And it was saying it had a deadly wound, and the deadly wound was healed. How does this apply to Rome? The first phase of Rome, the beast, was the Imperial Roman Empire begun by Julius Caesar. It was a dynasty of succession of Roman generals and kings, emperors, until that finally died out with the last 10 Roman kings were all, virtually all of them were assassinated, so that the successor of the assassinee, the successor of the one who was assassinated, became the new king. That's how corrupt Rome became in its final days. And so there was a period of total disorganization of Rome, where it had no leadership after these Roman emperors died out. And so there was a period, a very unquiet peace in the Roman Empire, in Rome and its outlying provinces during this period. However, what happened during this period was that the papacy emerged under Gregory the First. And the papacy took over the military empire that Imperial Rome had, and became a second version of the beast. So here we have, and this is very clear from the fact that the papacy still retains even today the title of Pontifex Maximus, High Priest of Jupiter, because the Imperial Roman kings demanded to be worshipped as gods, and their title was Pontifex Maximus. The papacy has retained this title in the term pontiff. And anybody who knows the history of the papacy knows that what they did not create Christianity. It's not a Christian faith at all. They combined pagan elements from Imperial Rome, such as Easter and Christmas and various other things, that, such as bunny rabbits, worship of Christmas trees, etc., etc. There's a great book called The Two Babylons by Alexander Hislop, which explains how the Roman Catholic Church retained many of the traditions of ancient Babylon and merged them together with the emerging Christianity, and that became Catholicism, which, by the way, Catholic means universal. The Catholic Church is a universalistic church. It is not a covenant church. It is not based on the covenants promised by Yahweh to his people Israel. Not at all. The Catholic Church has always been an imperialistic church, a church of Laodicea, which claims its own authority by force and rules over the people. That's the Catholic Church. It is in no way, shape, or form, as I said earlier, descended from Peter, nor does it teach scriptural Christianity. It makes things up just as the Jews make things up for their version of scripture. So therefore, beast number six, Rome, is the one that had the deadly wound and was healed. And that's the last beast before Napoleon. Napoleon defeated the papal states militarily, confiscated the property of the papacy in France and other nations, and basically reduced the papacy to a tenth-rate power, still having religious control over peoples, but wiping out entirely its military power. Therefore, and then, in fact, Napoleon put the Pope under house arrest, and the papacy was at Napoleon's whim. He could do with the papacy whatever he pleased. He chose to allow the papacy to continue as a religious power, but it no longer had any military power, was no longer capable of, you know, sending out troops to take over, let's say, the Albigenses or the Waldenses or the Huguenots. Of course, the Catholic Church was a military empire, and the Crusades, you can understand that the Catholic Church was a military empire, not just a religious empire. So when Napoleon came along, and it says very clearly in Revelation chapter 17, that when he comes, he shall continue for only a short space. And indeed, his reign was only 17 years, much shorter than any of the other beasts that preceded him. So now we have identified seven beasts in the book of Revelation. And again, let me just tell you that there is no denomination outside of Christian Identity that understands any of these things. And they will not tell you that the eighth beast, which I'm going to now explain to you, they will not even mention the eighth beast. Because for one thing, they don't know who the eighth beast is. And even if they did know, they would not dare to reveal its identity to you because they are entirely beholden to it. Thanks to 501c3, the IRS code, which demands that the Christian denominations not teach against homosexuality, not teach against Judaism, because don't you know they're God's chosen people, and therefore you cannot question the hoax of cost or any other lies promoted by the false prophet, that is false religion, and the eighth beast, namely Zionism, and the world bank, Jewish banking system. They will not dare to teach against these entities, and they will not dare to teach against sodomy and all forms of idolatry and fornication, because their real master is the dragon, Satan himself. Even though they preach in the name of Jesus, they are actually beholden to the beast, the dragon, the eighth beast of Revelation, which is ruled over by the dragon, Satan itself. So let's continue now with Revelation 17, now that you understand who these seven beasts are. And the beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth, and is of the seven, and goeth into perdition. Okay, we're being told here that the eighth beast has come from one of the seven. Well, let's take a look at ancient Babylon, the third beast. That beast is where the fractional reserve banking system was invented. In those days, they had clay tablets, which passed as money. Of course, gold, silver, and other commodities were accepted as money. However, these clay tablets, many of them were receipts, receipts for goods, receipts for farm goods, receipts for commercial goods, for trade goods, etc., etc. These receipts had a value in and of themselves because it said two pay to the bearer on demand, 10 sheep, let's say. So whoever had that receipt could take it to the guy who had the sheep and could claim those 10 sheep. And so if you had such a receipt, these receipts could be passed around from one person to another and became quote-unquote money. They became currency. In the same way today, we have paper money. Paper money was invented by the goldsmiths and their banks. In modern times, when gold and silver were money, they issued paper receipts, promissory notes. These promissory notes began to circulate as money because it's much easier to take a piece of paper from one person to another rather than a heavy bag of gold or a heavy bag of silver. And they just left the gold and silver in the bank while they exchanged these promissory notes for goods. So whoever was left with the promissory note could simply go to the bank and take out the amount of gold or silver that it stated on the promissory note. This made trade much more easy. However, it made fraud much easier too. How did the goldsmiths operate this fraud? Well, it's called inflation. And what they did was they realized that because these promissory notes were circulating back and forth among the people, and a very, very few of them ever came back with their promissory note to claim the gold they held in storage, they began to issue fraudulent promissory notes. And they realized that they could issue and circulate up to 17 times the number of promissory notes as there was gold and silver on hand. In other words, they could inflate the money supply by 17 times, spending it into circulation themselves, reaping all the profits, reaping all the goods that this inflation created. They have the principle of first use applies. If I'm the one printing the monopoly money, and everybody thinks it's real money, then they're selling me their goods. But if you're a victim of inflation, what you find out is that, let's say the inflation rate is 100% annual, which means the money supply doubles every year. Well, at the end of the year, you're going to find out that the money you have in your wallet is only worth half as much as it was the previous year. That's 100% inflation, 50% increase the money doubles in 1 year, and therefore the value of the money in your wallet decreases by half. And that is what is called depreciation of the currency. Now, paper money can be depreciated in this way very easily. All you have to do is print more. And if you print twice the amount of paper money in circulation this year as there was last year, you've got an inflation rate of 100%. Now, of course, the bankers don't dare inflate the money this quickly because people would catch on, hey, you're printing so much money that the stuff in my wallet no longer buys anything. It only buys half the stuff I used to be able to buy. So they do it very gradually over the years, over the decades, over the centuries. And that's how this has been accomplished. So again, this is the fractional reserve banking system with inflation thrown in, with promissory notes and fraudulent notes thrown in, which enables Mystery Babylon to take total control of your economy, your life, the life of your country. And in America, the controlling agency is the Federal Reserve Bank. By the way, it's not federal, and there's no reserve. There's no reserve of gold. There's no reserve of promissory notes. It's just paper money claiming to be money. It's actually currency, not money. Where our Constitution defines money in terms of a weight of silver, namely 371.25 grains of silver. That's a dollar, folks. That piece of paper called the Federal Reserve Note is not a dollar. It's a promissory note, or it used to be a promissory note. Today it promises absolutely nothing. It's nothing but a stinking piece of paper, and people have been conned, taken advantage of by this con game, into believing that it is money, and it's not. So folks, this is Mystery Babylon, the eighth beast, your slave master. It is these bankers who have created this system of Mystery Babylon, the fractional reserve banking system, which was reborn as the eighth beast from its initial heyday as the third beast of Babylon. That's why it's called Mystery Babylon. And because 99.99% of the people in the world today do not comprehend it and how it works and how it is your slave master, that's why the Bible refers to it as Mystery Babylon. And because the church has refused to teach about it, it remains a mystery. Well, it's no longer a mystery. The pastors and teachers of Christian identity have solved this mystery and are presenting it to you. Let's continue, because what we have here is war, economic warfare against the sovereign people of the world by these banksters using the fractional reserve banking system and inflation as their main weapon. And it says, the 10 horns which thou sawest are 10 kings which have received no kingdom as yet, but received power as kings 1 hour with the beast. And these are the nations that the Jewish banking system has given power unto in its wars against the world, forcing the institution of the fractional reserve banking system all over the world. And of course, we're told later on that these 10 horns will rebel in the book of Obadiah, that the Edomites who established these kingdoms, that they will wind up being victims of the 10 kingdoms because these 10 will rebel against it. So in other words, what we're seeing in the BRICS nations a rebellion against the global Jewish fractional reserve banking system, Mystery Babylon. We're seeing that take shape before our very eyes. These have one mind and shall give their power and strength unto the beast. all the NATO, you can call it the European Union, which is a function of Mystery Babylon. Federal Reserve is a function of Mystery Babylon. Every so-called national bank, which is not national, it's privately owned. Deutsche Bank, Federal Reserve Bank, Bank of England. These are not national banks. These are privately owned banks. And they're simply portrayed as national banks to fool you. They are privately owned. These shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall be over, and the Lamb shall overcome them, for he is Lord of lords and King of kings, and they that are with him are called and chosen and faithful. So you got two options. You're either with the beast and its fractional reserve banking system, or you are with Jesus Christ, Yahshua Messiah, obeying his laws and denouncing fraud, theft, con games, and the global empire of the war machine of Zionism, which is being financed by the House of Rothschild, Mystery Babylon. So you're either going to be on one side or the other. You can't be with both. That's why the Bible tells us in Revelation 18, come out of Babylon, my people. Now I've explained to you what Mystery Babylon is. And if you're working for Mystery Babylon, you need to get out. You need to get out of Mystery Babylon, find another line of work. If you're a warmonger, if you're working for Bechtel or Blackwater or any of these warmonger corporations, you're working for Mystery Babylon and you're with the enemy. So you need to get out. But you can't get out unless you understand what you're in. And you are in Mystery Babylon if you're working for them or do business with them. And then it says that the 10 horns which thou sawest upon the beast, these shall hate the whore, that is, just as in Obadiah, they shall rebel against the fractional reserve banking system. That is, after they understand how they've been hoodwinked by Mystery Babylon. And as I said, this rebellion is taking place right now. They shall hate the whore, and shall make her desolate and naked, and shall eat her flesh, and burn her with fire. So there's going to be a civil war amongst the nations of Mystery Babylon. Verse 17, for God hath put in their hearts to fulfill his will, and to agree and give their kingdom unto the beast, until the words of God shall be fulfilled. And the woman which thou sawest is that great city, which reigneth over the kings of the earth. What is that great city? It's that city within the city of London, the Rothschild Financial District. That is the great city that we're talking about, folks. That is your slave master. That is what Revelation 11:8 refers to as Egypt slavery, modern slavery. There has never been any power of slavery greater than this. If you accept in principle this Mystery Babylon economic system, you are a slave of it. And you are a victim of it. Because the Bible demands honest money, which is gold and silver. And without honest money, there can be nothing but slavery. Whoever is managing this economic system is your slave master, and you are a slave of the system whether you realize it or not. So that covers the Egypt aspect, that is the slavery aspect of the prophecy of Revelation of 11:8. Now let's get into the Sodom aspect of Revelation 11:8. Let's go, first of all, we need to identify the heresies of modern churchianity and how they have deceived you. If you consider yourself to be a Christian and you believe the teachings of the Catholic Church or the Evangelicals or the Protestants or the Seventh-day Adventists, any of these modern denominations, I'm telling you right now that all of these denominations are apostate. They do not teach the covenant message. They teach whatever they please, and they will interpret the Bible to suit themselves on every occasion. one of the great slanders and false teachings about the Bible by these, virtually all of these denominations, is that when Jesus died at the cross, all future sins were also forgiven. This is typical dispensationalism. That is absolutely not the case. The Bible teaches absolutely no such thing. And I'm going to prove it to you right here. From Romans 3, verse 25, we find out that whom God hath set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness. Righteousness is obedience to the law, folks. Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. For the remission of sins that are past, through the forbearance of God. So, the redemption at the cross only applied to the sins that are past. Your future sins are not forgiven. If they were, the Bible post the crucifixion would never talk about repentance. But all the apostles after the crucifixion constantly, including Paul, constantly talked about repentance. Well, if your sins were forgiven at the cross in 33 AD, then any sin afterwards, if you believe that all future sins were also forgiven, then, well, yeah, then there's no need for repentance. But the fact that they teach repentance constantly afterwards means that only past sins were forgiven. Let's go to 2 Peter 1:9, where Peter tells us the same thing. So we've got two witnesses telling us that only past sins were forgiven. There's no justification for teaching that all past, present, and future sins were forgiven. Here's how Peter puts it. But he that lacketh these things is blind. And he gives a long list of virtues and virtuous behavior that we're supposed to fulfill and do. But he that lacketh these things is blind and cannot see afar off, and hath forgotten that he was purged from his old sins. Not from all and future sins, only from his old sins. So, the idea that the crucifixion accomplished a forgiveness of all future sins and therefore the law has been done away with, that is heresy. Nor does the Bible say any such thing, that the law has been done away with. Put that expression in your browser or in your Bible search browser. Type that in. Done away with. The law has been done away with. Type that in and see if anything comes up. I guarantee you, you will not find it in Scripture. That is an interpretation, a false interpretation conjured up by the antinomians, that is, those who oppose the law. And Paul does not teach against the law. He says, the law is holy, just, and good. That's what Paul says about the law. But their interpretations and their pick and choose theology, where they pick a verse here and a verse there out of different books to reassemble them to teach antinomianism, that's how they do it, folks. That's heresy. And that is a modern heresy, which I like to call churchianity, which does not teach Christianity, but poses as Christianity. So here we have absolute proof that only our past sins, only our old sins were forgiven. One more note on this, Colossians chapter 2, verse 14. This is one of the verses that the antinomians claim teaches that the law has been done away with. The fact is, it teaches no such thing, absolutely no such thing. Again, we are being lied to. Let me read the verse. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. First of all, let me point out to you that nowhere here are the Ten Commandments mentioned, nor is the law mentioned. What is mentioned is the handwriting of ordinances that was against us. The word handwriting is the subject of the sentence. That in the Greek is the word chirographon, which means simply writing. But in context, what it means is a list of handwriting of ordinances. The offenses committed by the Israelites. That's what was nailed to the cross. Not the Ten Commandments, not the whole law, but our offenses, because that's what was forgiven. You see? There's logic to this. What was nailed to the cross was a list of our offenses. In other words, in modern terminology, let me read it as if it were written in modern English, blotting out the indictment of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. So the list of sins, which were the indictment against us, that's what was nailed to the cross. And these modern theologians of churchianity don't have the time to look up the meanings of words in the Greek and the Hebrew, and therefore teach heresy in their temples of ignorance. Folks, you're beginning to see that modern churchianity is just full of heresy and does not teach. Virtually nothing is scriptural coming out of these churches. So we have in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, I'm not even going to bother to quote it, I want you to read it for yourself, where Paul predicts the day is coming where a great apostasy, that is a falling away from the true faith, will occur in Christianity. And in 2 Timothy 4:3, chapter 4 confirms this, predicts the same thing, that the world will fall into licentiousness and sinfulness, and the world, because of this, will fall away from the true faith. Read it for yourself. So now we have this also factually accomplished in the world today, because these very same denominations that I have been criticizing are guilty of all the sins of Mystery Babylon. It's bad enough that the secular world is teaching homosexuality and fornication and warmongering and faithlessness, and is taking advantage of us through robbery, lies, and deceit, mayhem, and destruction. The churches are either winking at it or actually promoting it themselves. And so for our final, we're going to bring this right around to sodomy, where we see, first of all, in 1 Corinthians 6:9, we're told by Paul, but let me first stop off at 2 Corinthians 6:14 through 17, because this is applicable, and where Paul tells us not to associate with unbelievers. Yet, what we have today is these churchian denominations invite rabbis, Hindus, imams, voodoo teachers, actually into their pulpits to teach Christians what they should believe. What blasphemy is going on in these churches today? It's amazing. Verse 14, 2 Corinthians chapter 6. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? Well, if you're being taught from the pulpit by rabbis, imams, and Hindus, and virtually any other denomination, any other religion you can think of, these people are unbelievers. They don't believe Jesus Christ is the Savior. He says, I come not but for the lost sheep of the house of Israel. He only came for us. That prophecy has nothing to do with them. They're totally outside the covenants. The covenants weren't meant for them. Not at all. The Bible does not say so, and therefore I will not teach it. Yet these denominations of apostasy teach it. Verse 15, and what concord hath Christ with Belial? Paganism? Catholic Church incorporated paganism in the very early days. That fish hat that the Pope wears on his head, it's got an open mouth. It's the fish god Dagon from Babylon. And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. You, your body is the temple of the living God. These stinking churches, you don't need these churches. Jesus says, go into your closet and pray. Yet these denominations demand that you come to their house of Baal every Sunday and worship with them. You are being deceived. Revelation 12:8. The beast that deceiveth the whole world has come dressed in pastor's robes, has come dressed in Catholic robes, bishop's robes, Anglican robes. This is the false prophet, folks, teaching in the name of Christ all kinds of blasphemy that are not contained in the Bible, such as Jesus loves everybody, hate the sin, love the sinner, the law has been done away with. These are all nice sounding slogans, but they are not scriptural, folks. You are being deceived. So Paul tells us, wherefore come out from among them and be ye separate. How obvious can it be? If you are moving about among these pagan denominations, following their false teachings, you are a universalist, not a separatist. Come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean, and I will receive you. That word thing, if you look it up in your Bible, in your King James Bible, you will see it's italicized. Does not belong there. That means the King James Translation Committee added that word to make it sound like you're talking about inanimate objects. No, we're talking about people. Touch not the unclean people. The whole context is people. How can you be unequally yoked with things? Are we talking about carts? Are we talking about cars and planes? No, we're talking about people. And that includes Israelites who engage in all of these false teachings. We're supposed to reach out to them and try to convert them back to the true faith, bring them back out of the apostasy. But I guarantee you, we're not to associate with them until they become honest, Yahweh-fearing Israelites. Yet again, because they will stab you in the back if they are in fact unbelievers. So now let's go to Romans 1, 21 through 32, because I'm going to prove to you that the New Testament condemns homosexuality. Verse 21, where he lists a long list of sins which we are not to commit. This is after the crucifixion. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Of course, Paul is talking about contemporary Israelites of his day, but they have again become apostate. We're talking about the Lutherans, the Catholics, the Presbyterians, etc., etc. That's what we're talking. And they have become vain because, why have become vain? Because they believe the law has been done away with and they can teach, do, and say whatever they want. No, they can't. They better not blaspheme. Verse 22, professing themselves to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like to uncorruptible man, into birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. Well, they've allowed the pagans into the churches, who, what do? They worship the creation, not the creator. These people have been allowed in our churches. So Paul's condemnation here applies to the modern day churches just as much as they did to those standing before him. Now listen, wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lusts of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. So if your church teaches animism or paganism or voodoo or any unchristian doctrine, which they allow to be taught from their pulpits, these are condemned in no uncertain words here by Paul. And so, and how did they do this? For this cause, God gave them up to vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust toward one another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves the recompense of their error, which was meat. Men lying with men is clearly error. Paul says it right here. Women lying with women is clearly error, and it deserves recompense, that is punishment or judgment, which is appropriate. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. In other words, Yahweh has abandoned them to their lusts. This is not approval. These people come up with diseases such as AIDS and syphilis. And they spread these diseases among themselves. That's why homosexuals have roughly the half the lifespan of a heterosexual. And that's why they cannot be saved. He continues to conclude. I'm just going to jump down to verse 31. Without understanding, covenant breakers, indeed, they are covenant breakers, because they don't teach the covenants, and they break the covenant of the law as well, which Paul says is holy, just, and good. Without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, the fact that these homosexuals spread diseases among themselves means they have no concern or compassion for their victims. Verse 32, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. In fact, they enjoy sinning. They enjoy sodomy. They enjoy inflicting both pain and pleasure. Remember, the pain comes with the pleasure, and sometimes it just becomes nothing but pain, because homosexuals inflict harmful, painful acts upon each other and often kill each other through their attempt to gain sexual gratification through pain and pleasure. This is what homosexuals do, folks. And here, Paul is clearly telling us that this type of behavior is deserving of death. Now for Paul's teaching on the concept of effeminate and the fact that the effeminate nor the homosexuals will be allowed into the kingdom of heaven. Of course, this teaching totally contradicts the teachings of the churches today. But this is scripture. This is not churchianity. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 9 through 11. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind. In other translations, it's translated sodomites. Nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. And this is backed up completely in Revelation 21, where it tells us that no liars, fornicators, evildoers will enter the kingdom. Verse 11, and such were some of you, but ye are washed, but ye are sanctified, but ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. So those people who continue performing these activities will not inherit the kingdom of God. And to complete the thought, in John chapter 5, verse 29, we read similar thoughts by Jesus the Christ, in which he tells us that many will be resurrected unto damnation, but others will be resurrected unto glory. And this according to your works, according to your deeds, not according to mere belief. And here's the proof. John chapter 5, verse 25. Verily, verily, I say unto you, the hour is coming, and now is, when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that hear shall live. Now, it just doesn't mean listening. You have to understand and follow through. Verse 26. For as the Father hath life in himself, so hath he given to the Son to have life in himself, and hath given him authority to execute judgment also, because he is the Son of Man. Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming, in the which all that are in the graves shall hear his voice, and shall come forth. They that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. It's very clear that we are to be judged according to our good and evil deeds, not according to mere belief. That is a fantasy that has been taught by the churchians of the modern heresies, who do not quote these passages because they want to make you believe that all you have to do is believe that you are saved at the cross 2,000 years ago, and there's no more responsibility on your part to do good. Let me repeat this, because this seals the deal, and anybody who teaches otherwise is a heretic. And shall come forth they that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. So your evil deeds will carry you into damnation. And as Paul says, these people who practice fornication and homosexuality, that is sodomy, fornication, all kinds of sexual misdeeds, sexual error, sexual sin, these people will not inherit the kingdom of God. Any pastor or denomination who teaches you otherwise is leading you down the path of destruction. In the name of our Father Yahweh and his Son Yahshua the Messiah, I hope that you have plainly understood the teaching of today, that you are not to do evil, and if you do not repent of your evil deeds, there is no way you will see the kingdom. Praise Yahweh, pass the ammunition. Thanks for listening. This is Pastor Eli James. See you next time.